here's some advice. August 30th here, we're getting real close to September, so we're looking at September now, when we go month by month here, and the advice would be to just push whatever concerns we have about September, push them into October. Push them into October. Okay. Say, not now, maybe later. Not now. Maybe I'll be concerned about this later, but not now. So push all concerns into October. Okay, we can do this. It's a willful thing. Glass is half full right now, and we're not going to look at it half empty until maybe October, at the very earliest October. So we're going to stay positive, you see now. The success, you have to use your will. You have to use your will to decide how you're going to play it. And the ego says play it one way, the Holy Spirit says it play it the other way. And both of them seem to be quite adamant about it. And both seem to be very smart. You know, the ego's smart, clever, tricky. The Holy Spirit's wise. So you can't play it both ways, can you? You can't play it both ways. This is the whole key to the spiritual path and success. You cannot play it both ways. You have to choose one or the other. Either arrogance or our repentance. Either the ego or the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit says, you know, do not allow doubts and concerns, etc., to creep into you right now. Because this is the mood of September that the ego wants us to entertain all this. And we said, we're not going to entertain it until October at the earliest. So you have to be wise about your situation, and that is you have a severe continuity fear. I cannot overemphasize this enough. You hear it a million times, that's not enough. Hear it 10 million times. The ego plays on our arrogance, okay, and says, continuity fear, you're spirit, you're the son of God, you... What do you mean continuity fear? That's ridiculous. You don't have any continuity fear. And it plays up to our spiritual pride, okay? The Holy Spirit says, absolutely, you have a severe continuity fear. This is the problem. It's a severe continuity problem, it's continuity fear. Okay, so you need to be aware of this and be smart about it. So you cannot take absolute positions in the condition with this continuity fear. If you try to take idealistic, absolute positions, the ego gets leverage over you because you have fear, unacknowledged fear. And then this unacknowledged fear, the ego makes it seem like it's because you don't acknowledge that you actually have this fear. You say something's wrong, and the ego says, well, see, I'm right about that, that the Holy Spirit's trying to block you, you know, trying to block you, but if you just follow my advice, you'll be fine. So this is the whole struggle. It tries to get you into idealistic, absolute positions when you still have severe continuity fear, which produces this continuity fear, which is then projected and denied, and then it says the Holy Spirit's attacking you, trying to thwart, you know, your true happiness and blah, blah, blah. This is the whole thing. And so to be wise about it, don't take an absolute position. Refuse to take an absolute position. Because this is acknowledging, hey, I have a very severe continuity fear. To take an absolute position is going to cause, you know, severe fear and trepidation. And this is going to give the ego leverage over me. when the ego says, hey, be worried, you're going to fail, be concerned, failure's coming. We say, well, maybe, but not now, not now, maybe later. You see, well, maybe later, but not now. So is that an absolute position? No, it is not, right? You're saying, well, you know, ego, yeah, maybe failure's coming, but it's not coming right now. Maybe a little bit later. Yeah, it's possible a little bit later, right? So you refuse to take an absolute position. Another way to do it is you agree with whatever the ego says. That's a practice we did. Agree with your adversary. Sure, I'm a failure. Oh, yeah, of course, but I'm an absolute failure. I am an absolute, yes, I, ego, I'm an absolute failure. Perfect failure. You see, you can practice that way, as I've suggested, but also pushing the ego's, you know, objections to a little later. Say, no, not now, ego, not now, I'm busy right now, I'm not going to do it now, but maybe later, maybe in October, we'll be concerned about our safety and all this kind of stuff. So September is set up to be the ego's big month. Okay, the ego's big month. So what we're doing is we're bridging September right into October. You see, this is the trick. So September is designed to be this freak out month. The ego set it up. And we're not going to play that game. We'll say, well, you know, freaking out. Well, you know, ego, maybe we'll freak out, but not in September. Maybe in October we will, but not in September. And so we take this a priori stance before September even starts, you see, and say, no, we're not going to freak out in September no matter what. But if there's any freak out, October, we're just going to push it into October. And this is just a decision on our part. And we have the power to decide this. We have the power to react, to decide whether to react or not, actually. Our reactions are not mandatory at all. So before September even starts, we've already made the decision, you see. This is the Holy Spirit's wisdom. Okay. We're just going to push everything into October in terms of freaking out, negative reactions, all this kind of stuff. We're going to keep the glass half full all the way through September, no matter what seems to happen. And we're not going to react, freak out at all until maybe October. And we'll re-examine it in October, right? So September is going to be a completely positive month for us. We've already decided this ahead of time. It doesn't matter what happens. We're not interested. It doesn't matter. It's going to be an incredibly positive month for us. How about that? How about that? It's already a done deal. So, again, in listening to this, it's always a wow. You know, you're never going to hear some video here that doesn't have a lot of wow factor to it. But that's the whole point of it. This is the purpose of it. So that you can get used to managing this wow. And do not go into an idealist position. Refuse to be tricked into an idealistic position by the ego. You say, maybe yes, maybe no. Yeah, maybe I'm going to succeed and maybe not. See? Yeah, maybe I'm going to succeed and maybe I'm not. But this comes from a point of confidence, you see. The more confident you are, the more you're able to refuse to get cornered by the ego into some absolutist position. So, last night, a dream. Quite an amazing dream. Suddenly I was aware that this yellow duckling, this beautiful yellow duck was there, and it was looking at me intently, and then it moved towards me like this with its head and began to nuzzle me, and like I was his best friend, and it was a very soft and seamless feeling, you know, this downy young yellow duck, golden duck. And I said, wow, what's this? The duck is just has this very friendly. Someone said, wow, you've got a new friend there. That's amazing. And this duck was absolutely focused on me and intent on being my friend. And the feeling was this seamless, beautiful, soft, seamless feeling. You know how smooth the duck's feathers would be, and this sort of young duck with a sort of a downy, smooth downy feeling, you know, and it was just quiet like that. And I said, what in the world? This is amazing. Well, this is the feeling of eternal life, actually. It's the feeling of eternal life. And so the feeling of eternal life is going to come to me for sure. But I don't say that. In my practicing, in my focus, I say, well, maybe it's going to come, maybe it isn't, maybe it won't, and maybe this is the feeling of eternal life, and maybe it isn't. Or yes, this is the feeling of eternal life has come, and the feeling of eternal life has not come. So I refuse to be pinned into an absolute position, because that will kick up continuity fear, and the ego then will be able to use that against me. So what we do is we kick up continuity fear to evaporate it by saying, well, maybe yes, maybe no, maybe yes, maybe no, refusing to be pinned down, okay, conceptually pinned down by the ego. And then this allows the continuity fear to be evaporated. So I say, well, yes, the feeling of eternal life is coming to me. And no, the feeling of life is not coming to me. Yes, the feeling of life, eternal life, is both coming to me and not coming to me. It's both arriving and not arriving. This is, it's both it and not it. You know, this is it and this is not it. Now, of course, when you refuse to be pinned down conceptually to a position, it's just neutral. So when you're neutral, what's going on? Well, whatever is the truth then wins the day. You see, it's a fair contest that way, you see, because what isn't there isn't there, and what is there is there. But you don't have to take a position on it in order for it to be there, you see. So we refuse to take an absolutist position because of the continuity fear. This is just a no-brainer, and the more you hear this, the more you recognize, ah, of course, this is just pure pragmatism. And again and again and again, I say the only problem we have is the continuity problem. I've said this again thousands and thousands and thousands of times. It's the only problem anyone has is the continuity problem. There isn't any other problem. But if we fail to be aware and address this continuity problem pragmatically, then we're certain to keep on failing and keep on struggling with what we believe is mortality and mortal mind and suffering it terribly. There's no way around it. And, you know, very few are aware that we're suffering from a continuity problem. And so they just keep spinning their wheels. So we have to keep emphasizing this. We have it's extremely severe problem, and you have to be very pragmatic about it. Do not take an absolutist position. Or let's put it this way. You can practice assertions. In the third phase, we practice it, but we know we're just getting our feet wet. Okay, we're not really abiding in it. We cannot abide in a conceptually absolute position because of the continuity fear. We cannot. So the ultimate technique is to refuse to be pinned down. So the feeling of life, eternal life, is both here, and the feeling of life is not here. It's both here and not here. Yes, I'm both going to succeed and not succeed. See, this is what I'm saying. Even though the indications are very strong, I will say the indications are both very strong and not very strong. Okay. This puts a stop on the ego and what it's trying to do to you. But I can tell you the ego is pulling out all stops to stop me at this point. There's no question about it. From all angles. I'm getting hit from all angles right now. The ego is desperate, you know, to stop this, because what it does is it shows a contrast, and it shames everyone, which is a good thing. Spiritual shame is a very good thing. You say, wow, you know, whatever I'm doing, it's not working. Hasn't worked. It's not really, you know, I can see the contrast. This is very important. The ego doesn't want this. The ego will give you the whole universe as long as you don't feel the feeling of eternal life. And let's emphasize that this is a feeling. It's not a cognitive thought. It's not thinking. It's a feeling. This duck in the dream didn't say anything. It just gave me this feeling. That's all it did. It gave me a feeling of this smooth, you know, silky, so smooth and soft and gentle and calm and seamless. This is the feeling of eternal life. This is the feeling of eternal life. So it's not involved with thinking. So people say, well, what did you do? Well, I both did something and didn't do something. I both did something and didn't do something. So keep in mind that as long as we're here in this world, there is a potential for continuity issues to arise for us. There is. And so we have to remain in this mode of not being pinned down by an absolutist position. Be very careful about this. So the more we practice this, the closer we'll get to this feeling actually arriving for us. And we will say, yes, the feeling has both arrived and not arrived. I'm both feeling this and not feeling this. See, this is at a conceptual, intellectual, mental level, but the feeling is at this level, is at spirit. It's a feeling of spirit, the feeling of eternal life. So it doesn't matter, you know, we're saying, well, I'm both feeling this and not feeling this. This is just a way to keep, to protect ourselves from the ego, because, which is just all our, is our arrogance. And our arrogance is extraordinarily arrogant, extreme arrogance. And it's quite difficult to stand up to arrogance here, because the arrogance says standing up to arrogance is arrogance, as if arrogance is inevitably the winner. And to claim that you can somehow prevent it from being the winner, prevent it from being true, is complete arrogance. This is the standpoint of arrogance. Arrogance says that it's the new, is going to be the new truth. It's going to supplant God. And to say that it won't is sheer arrogance. You know? But again, arrogance hasn't done it yet, you see, at all. And so it's arrogantly asserting that it's a fait accompli, that it's going to defeat God. You know, well, isn't that the very definition of arrogance, is to claim a victory over God that you haven't won yet at all, and there's no evidence you ever will win it? You know, this arrogance is based on what? Nothing at all. Based on this dream of mortality, which is ridiculous. So setting arrogance down is not arrogant. However, we don't claim we've done. We say, well, yes, I've set it down and I have not set it down. I've absolutely set it down, and I've absolutely not set it down. So the ego is really upset. It says, I want teachers who are adamantly absolute, take the, you know, what is this wishy-washiness? Okay, so you don't really run into teachers that are, you know, taking this absolute position so much, right? Here. The you know, there's some great ones who can, but they don't really... You can't really pin them down, though. You can't pin them down. The ego says, "No, where are the teachers that I can pin down? You know, to an absolute position." Well, the teachers are here that are here, and have been here, are showcasing how we have to deal with our continuity problem, and they do not ask us to take an absolute position. They say, "No, well, both yes and no. I both did it and didn't do it. I both succeeded and not succeeded." Okay, so they maybe yes and maybe no. Yes, this is eternal life and it is not eternal life. Yes, it's the feeling of eternal life and not the feeling of eternal life. See, there's this, and we keep thinking, why are these teachers so mysterious and evasive, and you can never pin them down? Because they're showing us how you have to deal with the continuity fear here. And they do it in slightly different ways, but the principle is exactly the same. So, you know, the ego say, are you spiritually enlightened? I say, yes, I'm both absolutely spiritually enlightened and absolutely not spiritually enlightened. I had the experience with Longchamp. I said, you know, is the water hot or is it cold? Is it warm or is it cool? I want an answer. I tried to put him to the test. Is it warm or is it cool? And he said, both. It's both warm and cool. You see, so, right? You can't, you know, I mean, what do you, so this, that, so he's saying this is how you need to be entirely in your practicing. This is the very root of it all, is this attitude, this wisdom, is wisdom. And you have to hear this over and over and over and over, and I'm gradually getting it, you know, I'm just like anyone else, I'm gradually getting it, like, wow, yeah. You cannot take an absolutist position in this world where everybody is suffering from the most drastic continuity fear. You can make absolute statements to help people get acclimatized bit by bit, but when the ego tries to pin you down, hey, yeah, I'm both this and not this. I'm both here and not here. I'm both the teacher and not the teacher. I'm both eternal life and not eternal life. And so you refuse to, you know, so this is just showing others, compassionately showing others, this is how you have to say. You say, well, you know, maybe I'll take an absolute position later, ego, but not right now. So you can say this, well, yeah, sure, absolute position, sure, I might take that sometime, but not right now. Continuity fear is too severe for me right now. And the ego will always try to play up your arrogance, say, oh, what do you mean? You know, you're farther along than that, you're better than that. I mean, you should be able to get rid of the, no, never assume that your continuity fear is gone or that it's weakened. Never take that position. Okay, never assume this. This is so important to save, you know, infinite misery for everyone, really, is never assume, oh, the continuity fear is you know, so weak I should be able to just shove it aside. I don't really need to worry about it anymore. You never assume that. Never assume that. It's the most grievous problem. It literally has to do with our fear that we'll be devoid of functionality. Devoid of functionality because we're so used to pretending that we're not what we are that we feel if we stop pretending that we're not what we are, there'll be no more pretending taking place, and therefore we'll be devoid of functionality. So keep in mind, this is an extreme, extreme, the most extreme fear. It is just like almost absolute fear, you might say. We're afraid we'll be devoid of functionality. So never assume that you are free of the continuity fear. Always assume you have this very drastic continuity problem, and you need to be cautious about it. You need to be very cautious about it. So everything that I say preaches caution. Everything that I've said preaches caution. It's all in the context of full stop in the wow because of our continuity problem. And it couldn't be any clearer, you know. But again, the ego will try to put me in an absolute position there. So I'll say, yeah, I've made it absolutely clear and have not made it absolutely clear. So even here, the ego tries to get me. You see, tries to stop the Holy Spirit really from you know, enlightening me, and the enlightenment is a feeling. Enlightenment is a feeling. Keep this in mind. Enlightenment is a feeling. But then we'll say, yeah, and it's both a feeling and not a feeling, right? It's both. When so you can feel when the ego tries to backlash on you and pin you down somehow. And that's when you then, and it's not a contradiction, because the whole context of our path is a cautious context, a full stop in the wow context, a context knowing, admitting that we have this severe problem as a continuity fear. This is called the path of repentance. That's why I say we always practice in the mood of repentance. I've said it thousands and thousands of times throughout the many videos. Mood of repentance, mood of repentance. So it couldn't be any clearer, however, I say, yes, it's absolutely, it couldn't be any clearer, it's absolutely clear and it's absolutely not clear. I've made it absolutely clear and I've not made it absolutely clear. I've made it absolutely clear and absolutely not clear, you see. So as a viewer of these videos, if you get this, then you get it. And you'll say, yeah, I both get it and don't get it. Because we do move forward rapidly. It seems to be in a very absolute way. But we also, the whole context is in this full stop in the wow, severe continuity fear. And it's not a contradiction at all. It's pragmatic. The ego say, well, you're contradicting. You say, yeah, I'm absolutely contradicting myself and absolutely not contradicting myself. Jesus says, agree with your adversary quickly. It means the ego. The ego's our adversary, the voice of arrogance. And so even when you're defending yourself, you think, I'm in the right. Say, yeah, I'm absolutely in the right and absolutely not in the right. Don't take an absolute position, even when you're in the right. Look at Jesus. He refused to take an absolute position going towards crucifixion. Who are you? He wouldn't take an absolute position, no. He was showing us, you know, no matter what kind of pressure the ego puts on you, do not take a conceptual absolutist position conceptually, because we are, the continuity fear will then zap us. And we'll start going to a nervous breakdown. The wheels will start falling off. And I know we've all experienced this many, 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 many times. No question about it. So I'm an experiential expert on all of this that I'm speaking about. Having felt it, having experienced it, having gone through the worst of the worst of the worst of it. So speaking from experience, and also not speaking from experience, right, to forestall the ego. So you get that? We make some progress, and then we block the ego. We make some progress, and then we block the ego. We make some progress, we block the ego. Make some progress, block the ego. Yes, I'm making great progress, and I'm also not making great progress, right? But whatever is the truth remains the truth, no matter what you say about it, right? But again, what we want to avoid is retreating, is denying truth. So when we say yes, both this and not this, you know, we're really taking a neutral stance. Neutral stance. This is the wisdom of the path, the ultimate wisdom is to become more and more aware of this. As you become more and more aware of this, you begin to be wise about your path and say, wow, I really have the tools. I really have the tools. I just have to keep using them. And it's a struggle. I mean, I still struggle with it. So it's not about being smart. The ego's smart. It's about being wise. The Holy Spirit is wise. I say, yeah, well, I'm both making great progress and not making great progress. This is both very helpful and not very helpful. Someone will say, are these videos helpful? And you say, sure, they're very helpful and not very helpful. What do you mean? Well, it's both. It's both yes and no, really. And I'll say, why? You know, I can't pin you down and one or the other. He says, well, you know, I mean, I can both be pinned down, not pinned down, but, you know, maybe later you can pin me down on this, but not right now. I just, you know, it's just my decision not to really, you know, be definitive, you know, right now. Maybe later I'll be definitive about it, but, you know, it's kind of like it's both definitive and not definitive right now, right? So the ego always wants you to define, be definitive. Always wants you to be definitive. Keep in mind, what we are is absolute, pure, perfect abstraction. No definitiveness whatsoever. Okay, so we don't try to define no definitiveness because that would be definitiveness itself too. And we don't, you know, there's all sorts of clever tricks that the ego uses around all this. But we just say, not now, ego, maybe later. Maybe later we'll entertain you. And so you can tell when you're entertaining the ego, no matter how clever it is. It can be extremely clever, but it doesn't matter. We just say, hey, not now, ego. I don't have time for this right now. So maybe later, maybe later. I say, maybe later. Okay, that's not being entirely definitive. And the ego will do, you know, keep pressing you, but you just have to be, you know, well, you know, yeah, maybe, maybe yes, maybe no. Maybe yes, maybe no. So I'm both certain that this is very helpful and not certain that this is very helpful, right? So you see, a teacher, as soon as they take an adamant stance, the listener, the ego will say, hey, to the listener, hey, say this, think this, you know, take this position like that. And then it'll seem, oh, I see a great opportunity to, you know, to be super smart. See, the ego says, there's a great opportunity to be really, really smart. You're going to point out the mistake here or something like that of the, you know, the Holy Spirit. And you'll think, oh, yeah, I see this great opportunity. So this is what you have to avoid. There's never a great opportunity to point out the flaws of the Holy Spirit because the Holy Spirit doesn't have any flaws. Its wisdom does not have any flaws. So so when you hear that, that's the ego. And if someone takes, you know, has a context or an attitude of an absolute position, you know, then the ego say, ah, I have, here's my opportunity now to engage them in definitional games. And then you see, then the ego's got you and it's going to run you down. Oftentimes gurus don't admit they're gurus. What? I'm not a guru. Oh, I'm both a guru. What do you mean you're not a guru? You function like one. Well, I'm both a guru and not a guru. I'm both a guru and not a guru. Well, you're so absolute. Well, yeah, I'm both absolute and not absolute. Well, you're teaching great. Well, maybe I'm teaching great. Maybe I'm not teaching great. But we all think you're like, you know, divinity. Well, yeah. Yeah, maybe I'm divinity and maybe I'm not divinity. But how come you don't want to be a guru? Well, I both want to be a guru and don't want to be a guru. And they try, you know, the people say, I'm trying to be smart here and I'm not able to be smart. You know, that's the ego that wants to be smart. It's the ego that wants to be smart, wants to outsmart the Holy Spirit. Okay, the Holy Spirit has no interest in such nonsense. The Holy Spirit's entirely pragmatic. The Holy Spirit knows truth. And truth is a feeling. It's not a smartness, it's a feeling. And all the smartness in the world that the ego generates will never be that feeling of eternal life. It will only be pumping up the ego. It'll be an egoic feeling of mortal life, like I feel more in control, like I'm getting some control here, or I'm pinning someone down, or I'm winning, or I'm defeating something. The ego gets its kicks from trying to defeat something, trying to stop something, trying to, you know, like that. This is an ego trip. So, you know, real spiritual teaching is about this wisdom of stopping the ego from pulling you back into the pit of belief in mortal mind. It's the wisdom of how to see, maybe not now, ego, maybe later, you know. Now I can't entertain you right now, but maybe later, maybe later. I'm not saying I will never entertain you. Don't say, ever say ego. I will never entertain you. You completely, you know, shut the door. Say, well, maybe later. Maybe later. Maybe later. Not now, maybe later. Not now, maybe later. This is very, very important. And when you practice this, you will feel, oh, I do have this tool that's very effective. So September is going to be the month of egoic arrogance for the ego, but we're not going to react to it. We'll say, well, I'm not going to give really an opinion on ego one way or the other until maybe October. I've just decided. I've both decided and not decided. But yeah, I'm not going to do it now. I'm busy. I'm busy, and this is just, you know. And if you're angry with me about that, and you're claiming this is an absolute position, blah, 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 well, we'll talk about that maybe in October, but we won't talk about it in September. So you can use this technique also. You can use this technique. Sometimes you need to have both of these and say, well, you disagree. You think that I'm being absolute. And says, well, you know, maybe I am, maybe I'm not. When I say, well, not now, maybe later, you're claiming this is an absolute statement and you need to defend it then. Well, I'll say, well, yeah, maybe it is an absolute statement, maybe it isn't. I'm not going to make a decision on this at this point, entertain this, but maybe later we'll talk about this ego, maybe in October. Of course, the ego say, you can't do that. You can't do that. September, I mean, this is my month. I'm going to crush you. I say, well, we'll talk about that, whether you crushed me or not in October. Well, do your best, ego. Say, hey, knock yourself out. Do your best. But, you know, I'm not going to evaluate it or define it or anything until maybe October. Maybe, you know, maybe yes, maybe no in October. We'll see when we get there. So you see, it's about an attitude, isn't it? It's about wisdom, it's about an attitude. It is not all this conceptuality, is it? It's about sidestepping it, you know, pushing that aside. Because eternal life is a feeling. It's not even an abstraction. An abstraction is a feeling. Abstraction, because of our pretending, we automatically, no matter what we pose as, it's automatically some sort of perceptual, conceptual construct, no matter what we say. So, but eternal life is just a feeling. It is just a feeling. There's no really construct, you know, even an abstract construct attached to it. And no matter what juggling you do, there's no juggling attached to it either. There's no juggling. So I'll say there both is and there isn't juggling attached to it. There both is and isn't juggling attached to it. So this is how we practice. This is our attitude. This is our main practice on the spiritual path, is awareness of the continuity fear. Recognizing that this will stop us cold and drag us back into hell if we do not become wise about it. You see, it's you know, not many have succeeded really in this world. Why? Because the continuity fear is so severe, and the wisdom about how to deal with it is easily overlooked. And of course, the ego doesn't value it at all. Ego says, well, I want you to be a great spiritual teacher. You know, what the heck are you doing equivocating like this? You can't be a great spiritual teacher if you're all equivocating like this. You got to be adamantly certain. And, you know, and actually, this is not so at all. Because the feeling is present. It's the feeling that's present. There doesn't need to be any adamant certainty about the feeling. It's simply present. It is. And like I said, the sun giving a tan to us, even though we don't know how it's doing, it's giving us a suntan. The feeling of eternal life is giving us a spiritual suntan, no matter what we're saying or thinking about it. Reality doesn't need to be reassured that it's real at all. So our job is just not to get in the way of that. Okay, that's all our job is. And so we don't have, it's funny, it's the ego that's trying to make us into this great guru, great teacher, based on its beliefs that you must be this, you know, adamant, absolute, conceptual, you know, attitude, that kind of thing. It's the ego that's doing that. That the Holy Spirit is not saying that. It's saying both yes and no to that, both yes and no. Because here you can define anything as anything, can't you? Definitions are completely arbitrary, actually. So, of course, definitions will be attached, but you just have to be like water off a duck's back, which is another thing, the duck symbols being in the world but not being affected by it in any way. And the feeling of eternal life is that situation where no matter what, anything the rain pours down, you know, it just rolls right off the duck's back. It doesn't get into the duck at all. And your duck, you're waterproofed. Ego-proofed. So the ego has this image of what a teacher should be. Why? So it can attack the teacher. Okay, the ego wants you to be a teacher that can be attacked by the ego. And the ego thinks, well, that's the great teacher. And so the ego's mind, the greatest of all teachers, is one that has this flaw that it can attack, a way to be attacked. And the ego wants you to be that teacher. And the ego says, if you're not that teacher, then you won't be the greatest of teachers. He says, you're coming up short. You're coming up short. Not true. The greatest of teachers are the ones who have seen through this dynamic of the ego and say, no, that is not the greatest of teachers. The greatest of teachers is the pragmatic teacher. Who do not fall for the ego's ideational definition of what a great teacher should be. And you can say, well, yeah, I'm both that and not that. Absolutely that and not that. Because again, everybody here is going to have definitions. You know, if there's no one here that needed spiritual help, they're all enlightened, then it's all a moot point. But obviously, that's not a case, so it's not the moot point. You know, everybody does here have a severe continuity problem, and therefore, pragmatism is the teacher here. That is the teacher, spiritual pragmatism. That is the teaching. And therefore, it's the teacher and the teaching. And so the ego's always trying to push us, like, wait a minute, you know, you're settling. This guy doesn't know what he's talking about. The ego says, you're settling for second best, you know. This will get you in a lot of trouble. You don't know what he's talking about. This is how to really be enlightened. You know, this is what the ego says. And you think, oh, yeah, I mean, I'll be able to be really, if I'm just adamant enough, I can heal everybody. Everybody's, you know, just like that. That's the ego's claim, because the ego, again, denies the continuity fear, knowing that in doing so, it will keep you bound to arrogance. So the ego puts all its efforts into trying to get you to deny that you have a continuity fear, that you have this, you know, bad habits, but ultimately these bad habits equal a severe continuity fear. You have a severe continuity fear, and the ego puts all its efforts into getting you to deny this. And so its idea is that there's some great savior that can come and just, you know, wake everybody up. They just say, hey, okay, I just adamantly said you're awake, you know, that's it. And if you're not that, the ego says, well, you're just some second bit, you know, blah, 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 screwed up, messed up, inconsistent, you know, not really helpful teacher. You're not good. You're hurting people. You know, kind of stuff. This is what the ego will say, and so. You know, we feel like, oh gosh, I mean, I want to be helpful here. I want to be more helpful in the world. So the ego always seems like it's pushing you to be more helpful in the world by pushing you to its idealized image of what a teacher is, which is, of course, that which completely denies the continuity fear. And this terrible flaw, you know, that the ego then can attack it and gets the leverage over it. So it wants you to be an ineffective teacher, really, the ego. Completely ineffective, but idealized. You know, ineffective, but idealized. Now, you might say, well, that just has to do with you. No, I mean, no, it has to do with everyone, because we're all teachers of eternal life. We'll be teachers of eternal life, every single one of us, because we'll all have this feeling of eternal life will all dawn upon all of us. And as we're getting close to this and it dawns upon us, etc., then we will most certainly be teachers of eternal life. And another thing that the ego does is to try to get those who are genuine teachers, it tries to try to drive them into an idealized position by having nobody pay attention to them. This is what the ego says, well, we're not going to pay attention to you until you're this idealized teacher, you know, egoically idealized definition of a teacher. We're just going to ignore. And it tries to pressure you, you know, in that way. And you think, oh, you know, I'm not being effective. I'm not really helping enough. I need to do more to help, etc. And you must also refuse to fall for this trap. Even if zero, you know, nobody, you don't feel you're helping anyone, you still have to stick to your guns about the continuity fear and don't get pinned down in an absolutist position. And at some point, when eternal life dawns upon you, then the ego's lost the game, because you're going to be helping everyone whether they admit to it or not. It's like the sun is shining and giving everyone a tan. You know, everyone out in the sun, you're getting the sun, whether you believe it or not, you still are. Or the heat from the sun. I mean, the sun's out today and everything's getting its heat. You might have all these trees and vegetation saying, no, it's dark, it's night, I'm not getting any, but it still is. You know, it's still growing, whether it claims it is or not. It's still, you know, receiving the heat of the sun. So this is what the ego, you know, is scared of, right? So it plays all these games of arrogance. And we just have to recognize this within us. The games, you know, the ego, these games are something within our mind, within everyone's mind, that are, you know, trying to intimidate each one of us from this. And so ultimately, that the problem is within us. Right, each one of us has to recognize, you know, our projections and how the ego is trying to deceive us, absolutely. And the ego can be very seemingly clever, okay, but it's never outfoxes the Holy Spirit. So we have the advantage here, and we'll press the advantage in that we're saying we're not going to react to September. We'll do that maybe in October. Okay? Maybe in October. So we're going to keep the glass half full, you know, and continue on with a very, very positive. It doesn't matter what happens in September. Even if the asteroid strikes and, you know, all this kind of stuff happens, we'll react to that maybe in October. Maybe in October. You know, whatever happens, we'll react to it maybe in October. You know, of course, the ego says, no, that's terrible advice. Terrible advice. You know, of course, that's what the ego's going to say. So I say, yeah, well, that's both great advice and not great advice. And then let you decide, you know, how you're going to play it. the gurus will say, well, whatever anyone wants to say about me, it's all equally fine. Good, bad, I agree with it all. Yes, you know, whatever the ego says, I agree. Agree with it all. I both agree and don't agree. I say that. I absolutely agree with you, ego, and absolutely do not agree with you. See, spirit is not troubled by this in the slightest bit. It's the ego that is troubled by this. The ego says, no, 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 I want you to either agree or not agree. I want you to start going towards some definite position. Get that. I want you to start going towards some definite position. This is what the ego wants for us, and it thinks it's doing good for us. Well, you got to have some definite position. How else are you going to have an identity then? Ah, you see, how else are you going to have an identity? Which means, if you don't have a definite position, you're going to wake up to eternal life, and you're going to stop pretending that you're not eternal life, and you won't have the functionality of pretending. So what the ego is really saying is, well, how else are you going to have an identity? It means your identity is based on pretending. And if you lose that, you won't have an identity. This is exactly what it's saying. And not saying. It's both exactly what it's saying and not exactly what it's saying. Okay? And what are we doing? Blocking the backlash. So I will say something adamant, and then I will shift into blocking the backlash. Now you can say for yourself, yes, I can say something adamant. I see clearly this is adamantly true, and then I'll say yes, but it is adamantly true and adamantly not true, where you then do not allow the ego to start playing with your mind, you see? Because you have to block the ego from playing with your mind. Otherwise, the continuity fear will say, help, help, help. I'm afraid I won't have any functionality. Help, who's going to help? And the ego will rush in and say, oh, okay, don't worry. I can push you to some definite position. Definite position, right? Definite position. Something definitive. Whereas our true being is completely non-definitive. Okay. And again, the ego will try to play games with us, so we'll say it's both non-definitive and not non-definitive, right? But you know, we already know what we're getting at. So this is the seeming awkwardness, but it's not awkward. We do become aware of the absolute truth here. Absolutely we do. But we also profess that we're not aware of the absolute truth. We're both aware and not aware. And this technique is to block the ego from starting to play with our continuity fear. We cannot allow the ego to play with our continuity fear. So we block it, and we just allow it. We have confidence it will dissipate. Okay? Instead of saying, oh, help ego, you know, help, you got to do something, we'll say, hey, just let it evaporate here. It'll evaporate on its own as we just sit in the neutrality here for a moment. So again, assertions, the wow arises, full stop in the wow. We talk a little bit about it, flipping the script. More assertions mean you're taking absolute position. Block the ego, full stop in the wow. More flipping of the script, more assertions. This is the path. It's very streamlined. My whole goal is to streamline the path. So I'm not beholden to any of the traditions of this world. I'm not beholden. I never have been. As I want to streamline it. Let's streamline it. And we deserve it. We deserve it. I mean, we've had these traditions for thousands and thousands of years. You know, and they've collected a lot of baggage. The Ramana Maharshi said, wow, there's so many spiritual teachings and traditions and all of this. And he said, and, you know, he says, hey, it's what a pity. What a pity. He says, it's you can streamline it. You know, you can streamline it, and I'm part of that mission to streamline it all. So, you know, I'm not beholden to any traditions, and it's not a matter of being iconoclastic. It's a matter of bringing in a streamlining, and we're ready for it. Just like Jesus brought in A Course in Miracles, Jesus says, you're ready for it. Well, this is a tremendous step forward, you know, really. It's just extraordinary, but he says, you're ready for it. You deserve something better now. You've done thousands and thousands of years of work, and now it's time to realize that you can see it more clearly. And so I'm part of this mission of streamlining spiritual truth going forward. You know, how can we really go forward with glass half full at this time unless we feel, hey, there really is a streamlined way. It is a lot simpler than I thought. I really can get to it instead of all this massive complexity. You know, that those at the top is like almost become a Ponzi scheme now. Those at the top can always, you know, authoritatively say to those, well, you got to do this and this and this and this, and you got to go through the tradition. But, you know, it's like going through a hall of mirrors almost, you know, at this point, after thousands and thousands of years. This is what happens here. Because of the continuity fear, the ego gains all this leverage and tries to make it as complex as possible. And then those on top of this will say, no, this, you know, you have to do it within this structure, you know, kind of thing. And it's so what I'm here to do is to streamline the entire thing. Fresh approach. And we need to become aware of the continuity fear. You know, this just, once you become aware of this, the ego is on the ropes. Absolutely. And then you become aware of this blocking technique. Okay. And when you have the awareness of continuity fear, awareness of this blocking technique, where you refuse to get pinned down to an absolutist position, and the ego cannot, you know, try to tell you, well, you can't be a really great teacher in this way. You know, as long as you wear that's the ego trying to trick us. And you keep practicing this. Yeah. The ego's, you know, is finished. It's out the door. It's that simple, actually. So, you know, Ramana Maharshi actually was here to help simplify the whole thing. And he's helped with some others too. Longchenpa, Jesus Christ. Those are the three really that I'm mentioning. Three that have really helped me. And the goal is to simplify it, to streamline it now. We cannot go forward anymore with the baggage of the past. This is the end of this world cycle right now. We're in the apocalyptic time, and then the end of this world cycle is going to say, I'm not saying that this planet's going to like disappear or anything. It's going to be remodeled at some point in the future. It will most definitely be remodeled. But the point is, this is the end of a world cycle. And we're making our decision. Are we going to go with the tech people, which is really, you know, Stone Age, you know, folly, which is catering to the flesh? Are we going to cater to the flesh and or the pride of the flesh and make us think, wow, look how catered I am. You know, look how catered I am. I can see 3D. I have these, you know, Google lenses on. I'm going to immerse myself in this environment. Wow, I'm so, technology is catering to me so wonderfully. I'm some awesome person. I'm being catered to like this. Are we going to go in that direction? Or are we going to continue to say, no, I want to go in the direction of eternal life and I'm going to stay with spiritual path. The problem is right now, the spiritual paths in the world have become so, you know, so confused, so complex and confused, and the baggage and everything. People say, wow, it's just too difficult. I can't do it. So what we're saying here is that we're streamlining it. And this is what we're doing. And succeeding at it. And of course, both succeeding and not succeeding at it. To block the ego. If I didn't block the ego, I wouldn't be able to talk like this. You know, it would freeze me up, like paralyze me, actually. Absolutely. If you let the ego in, it'll actually paralyze you. So, just the fact I'm able to articulate means I have to also be, you know, blocking the ego, blocking, maybe later, ego, maybe later, yeah, maybe you can get me later, you know, maybe you'll be able to spring your trap later, but not right now. So we've really had this, there's been this streamliners of actually in the 20th century, there's been those who realized that in order to go forward because of this secular materialism which has gripped the world, that this super catering to the mortal flesh and senses that makes us arrogantly feel like we're special. In order to get past this, we have to streamline spiritual teaching, so people feel, oh, it's not as difficult as I thought. What is true, it's not as difficult as we have thought. And, you know, I highlighted Christianity, how they struggled. The record is very clear. And it's that way, everything, that there's been lots of struggles, lots of opinions this way, that way, you know, this is ascendant, combination of this now, maybe it becomes just massively complex. It's that way in all traditions. And those who try to say, no, we have the pure way, it's just, no, it's not true at all, historically. It's not true at all. And I've showed that in Christianity very, very clearly. All sorts of compromise positions, all sorts of side trips, you know, just. And of course, people out, yeah, well, Christianity's fine, but the other traditions, oh, they're nice and clear. No, it's not true either. But I'm not going to spend time on all that. I've already done that previously in years gone by, etc. You know, it's obvious, you know. So the ego doesn't want us to streamline it. You see, the ego loves this complexity. It loves the rules and the complexity and got this and that and that. And it doesn't want you to see the continuity fear. When you start being aware, wait a minute, I do have this continuity fear. Great. Because when you become aware of this, the whole situation simplifies for you. And, you know, immediately you feel like I'm already almost there, which is true. Because you've taken the greatest step, which is to realize I have the severe continuity fear and I need to deal with it. So when the Holy Spirit began to point this out to me, I knew right then and there I was going to succeed. There's no doubt about it. And the Holy Spirit said, you just have to work at it, evaporate it. You know, that's all there is to it. He says, yeah, it'll take you a while. It's a lot of work. But for sure, you're going to do it. And so I believe the Holy Spirit. I knew this is true. I knew this is true. So immediately you feel free of all the complexity of all the religious traditions of the world. You just feel free of it. It just can't get to you anymore. And you become aware that it's a problem that you actually have. Therefore, you can deal with it. You see, as long as the ego tells you you don't have this problem, how can you deal with it? It's in everybody else. So you try to deal with everybody else and control everybody else. You can't say this. You can't do that. You got to do this. There's that. You know, instead of seeing it within yourself. So when you see it within yourself, you say, wow, this is great. I actually have the problem. So I can, therefore, get rid of it. Free myself from it. This is fantastic news. The best news ever you'll ever have is you realize you do have a severe continuity problem because you realize it's something that I can get rid of. Whereas somebody else has it, well, they're still controlling it. So then you feel you have to control them somehow, which then causes just all this extraordinary difficulty in your life. And you say, I'm not able to control them. This is horrible. They're a terrible person. What am I going to do? I got to, you know, scheming, you know, and you get so angry and stuff. I have to control somebody else. You know, they have the problem. They're causing me the problem, not me. But if you realize, oh, I have the problem that's causing me my problem. It's just simply a continuity problem. Once that continuity problem is evaporated, I'm going to have a feeling of eternal life. Guaranteed. No doubt about it. Therefore, I just go to work on myself. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that wonderful? You see how culture, society, how wonderful it would be in this context. Is everybody taking responsibility that the only problem I have is the continuity problem. So imagine a world, a dwelling place that's like that, where people who repent and realize, hey, the only problem I have is the continuity problem. I don't have any other problem. And then they go to work on evaporating it. How much better that would be. What a better world that would be, right? And we may have such a world. We may go to such a world. It's possible. Those who repent. We were promised, you know, that the repentance, those who are willing to admit that, hey, I do have this continuity problem. That's the ones who have repented. That's the definition of repentance. It's not something abstract. It's definitely recognizing that, you know, that each one of us say, I have the problem, the continuity. It's the continuity problem. It's a very severe problem. It's the only problem I have, but very severe, and I have it. You own it. I have it. And it means I also can work on it. All the time, because I have it. I'm never without it. It's not like somebody else has. Hey, I need to, you know, be with you because you have the problem. I got to work on you. No, I have it. I can work on it constantly, wherever I am, and I can also get rid of it because I'm the one who has it. I can set it down. I can evaporate it. Gone. And when it's gone, it's gone. This is the huge advantage of repentance. The huge advantage of repentance. Have to have that leverage. or else the ego will just play you for a fool. Arrogance will play you for a fool, for sure. You might be a cool fool, but you'll still be a fool. You won't have the feeling of eternal life. You won't have the feeling of eternal life, and you'll just be waiting, trying to control others, you know, trying to control others. If I just, they're the problem. If they don't have eternal life, then I will, you know, because, you know, they're the problem. So that never works, never works. So, but it's very simple. Just say, I got that. I have the continuity problem. I'm the one who has the problem with the continuity problem. And so I need to progressively get closer and closer and closer to the feeling of eternal life, but then keep blocking the ego from, don't take any absolute position. Yeah, I'm both very close and not very close. I'm both very close and not very close. Absolutely, I'm absolutely very, very close to the feeling of eternal life. I'm absolutely not very, very close to the feeling of eternal life. And when you really assert this, oftentimes I take a deep breath of relaxation. I just feel like I'm, tremendous pressure has been lifted off of me. So, a September to remember will be remembered in October. Okay. So, September for us will not even be on the calendar, so to speak. We'll experience it in October if necessary. Meanwhile, we're going full bore with what we're doing here. Full bore. So you never know what I'm going to pour out here, you know. some gratification for the eyes, eye candy maybe. It both is and isn't eye candy. And, you know, it's like we're going to want some kind of gratification for the flesh, right? So it's better to keep it in-house in terms of a little bit of eye candy. And then you say, oh, okay, all right, that's nice, but it really wasn't it. And then you go back, you know, to more intense consideration like this. In Romano call it inquiry. We call it, you know, consideration. Consideration here. And full stop in the wow practice. Ramana Maharshi was a great streamliner because he hardly gave out any teaching at all. He was helping us move forward. There are a number of such teachers that have helped us move forward in the 20th century. They didn't say much. They didn't teach much. They didn't identify with any tradition in particular, actually. They just radiated this feeling of eternal life to us. That's all. Just radiated this. And what happened was we said, wow, this feeling of eternal life, it really is real. This is the bottom line. I mean, they motivated the world. They motivated the world, these great teachers, by simply feeling, they just allowed the feeling of eternal life. And so many of us picked up on this, says, wow, I want that feeling too. And then once we have this motivation, then it becomes much easier to recognize that we have a continuity fear, and this is the only problem we really have. And then we are able to streamline the entire spiritual path. We do not need to jump through all the hoops of all the traditions at all. At all. So I know this is very helpful, even though the ego insists it's not. Well, the ego is very clever. It says, well, you could be a lot more helpful. Sure, you're helpful, but you could be more helpful. But the Holy Spirit says, yes, says differently. The ego says, hey, say, yes, I know this is absolutely helpful, and I know this is absolutely not helpful. Okay? Don't get caught up in the ego saying, well, yeah, this is helpful, but it could be a lot more helpful. You know? Because it's really a denial. The ego's saying, no, 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 no. You need to fit the image I have of as a teacher. See, the ego has this image of a teacher, what it wants it to be, and is insisting you fit into that image. All of us insisting that, and so it says, well, yeah, you're helping a little bit, but don't you want to help more? This is its shtick, its trick. Oh, I see you're being helpful, but wow, I mean, you could be so much more helpful. You know, meaning you could be much better teacher than you are if you just, you know, just begin to take some definite positions. I mean, because you'd be helping people get a definite sense of definite identity, you know, definitional identity, which the ego thinks is the only identity that, you know, there is. Without that, you'd have nothing. You know, this is so the ego saying, well, yeah, I sort of see that you're kind of helpful. You got some potential, the ego will tell you. Yeah, you got potential, but you could be a lot better. So, it is true that when we come into this world, we come into a world where there's this idealized image that the ego has of what a spiritual teacher is. And when you say, well, I'm here to be a spiritual teacher, the ego say, great, we need a lot more of them. Wonderful, I'll help you. I'll do everything I can to help you. You say, oh, really? That's very nice of you, ego. Oh, yeah. And so I'll help you, you know, become this idealized image of a teacher. Of course, what that does is prevents you from being a real teacher. Effective teacher means effective. It means it prevents you from feeling eternal life because you're desperately trying to fit a definition. You're trying to be definitional. Okay. This is the problem everyone has here. You know, very few are able to get through that. The great teachers that we know, some of them recently, they were able to get through it. Ram Maharshi, for example, you know, he just said, it was time to start teaching. Okay, boom. He lay down. Okay, and he went through this consideration of impermanency and dying and whatever he did, you know. And then, that's it. He said, right then, I was free. You know, I had the feeling of eternal life. I was abiding in it. Just like that. But, you know, so it didn't get to him. He did not buy into this idealized image of what a teacher should be that the ego, you know, is ferociously insisting upon if you want to really help people. So to the ego, Ramana Maharshi was a failure. So what a failed teacher? The ego says, ah, what an idiot. He just sat there quietly, not really taking any adamant position. You know, it's just like, what a waste. What a waste of potential, you know. Stupid. That's how the ego views Ramana Maharshi, a waste of potential. Could have been a great teacher, but came up short. You know, this is how the ego will view you. See, the ego say, oh, they could have done so much more. If they just listened to me, and it could have done so much more. Meanwhile, here's this great spiritual son just giving everyone a spiritual suntan, you know? And we're saying, wow, I like this spiritual suntan. I think I'll get some more. Yeah. I remember when young, you know, like before they said, well, the sun's rays gives you cancer, skin cancer, and all this. You're going to look like a shriveled prune later. I mean, getting tan was the coolest thing there was. Absolutely the coolest thing there was. And so we were after the perfect tan. Absolutely. I mean, our generation. This, of course, they came up with tanning beds, you know, and everybody's jumping into tanning beds, and they totally said, well, that gives you cancer, too, and all this stuff. But what we really were after was a spiritual tan. But since the ego was telling us, no, it's not really, it's the external, it's the tanning of the body, which is cool. You know, that will give you even more coolness than the spiritual tan. So then we all got in, you know, to, yeah, I want to look, you know, this perfect, ideal, glowy tan, you know. And of course, the cosmetics came out and ladies would apply this all over their faces and butt and arms. And then they came out with, you know, artificial tan, you know, but they give this sort of a sparkle glow, you know, this sort of makes your face complexion glow. So, you know, you get into this body complexion thing. What's the body complexion? And this is the ego. This is the ego saying, now you can do better. And that's, well, spiritual tan was fine, but, you know, you can do better. Give a body tan. Everybody will think that's really cool. Amazing, right? So all this is being brought to light is this wonderful time called the apocalypse. The apocalypse is a super positive time. People, ego says, for the ego, it's very fearful because everything's being brought to light now. The ego's losing. And so very fearful. The ego even denies it. Ah, it's silly apocalypse. That's nonsense, you know. But it's wonderful. I'm absolutely enjoying the apocalypse, surfing the apocalypse. So surf the apocalypse. Glasses half full, surf the apocalypse, enjoy all this stuff coming to light, because the bottom line is you find out what a liar the ego is. It's nothing but a liar and deceiver and a murderer from the very beginning, as Jesus told us. And it's wonderful to find out you have a problem, because then you can set it down. If you don't have a problem, but you're still not happy, then you think that someone else has a problem that's causing you the problem. You have to convince them to set it down. And you never can do it. It never works, right? You're so frustrated. But I have the problem. Wonderful. Thank God. And in this apocalypse, you start realizing all the mistakes you made in your life. And thank God, you say, oh, thank God I did make a mistake, instead of just the natural way that, you know, my life goes. No, it went the way it did because I made a mistake, a crucial mistake. I tried to fit into the idealized image of a teacher that the ego insisted upon in order to be, quote unquote, more helpful. You see that. You say, oh, thank God, you know, I did make a mistake. And then seeing that, you say, well, I can then correct the mistake. So seeing that you made a mistake, I say hallelujah every time I see I made a mistake. This is the greatest thing ever. I'm like euphoric, elated, because I said, oh my gosh, I can correct that, yeah. But if I hadn't made a mistake and this is the way I am without even making any mistake, how can I correct it? You know, there's nothing I can do about it, right? So, path of repentance. Yeah, I have a problem, continuity problem. Yeah, I made mistakes trying to fit into the idealized image of a teacher, trying to be more helpful, got tricked by the ego. And yeah, there was a ton of pressure put on me to succumb to this. Yeah, I understand that. But I know that I can correct the mistake. I don't have to succumb to it. No. Because really, I succumbed to it because I wanted to help more, thinking that, okay, I need to help more because people aren't getting it. But they're not getting it because they lack the streamlined. They're still bound by tradition. Okay? So I have to realize that it's not about the world as it's been. It's about, how are we going to be going forward here in a new dispensation? It could be a new planet, new dwelling place. We'll see. I don't know for sure. It's very possible, though, that those who repent will, you know, the sheep and the goats will be separated. We're told this at the end times, the sheep and the goats will go their separate ways. All right. The goats are the ones who are following the ego. The sheep are the ones who are following the Holy Spirit. And those who repent and say, yeah, I do have a problem. Hallelujah. You know, then a great spiritual civilization can arise of practice. And everybody there is going to be liberated. You know, it won't take so long, actually. It won't take that long. So you could say, go to a spiritual planet, a very spiritual dwelling place. Or, you know, do it here, but I don't see, you know, how it would work out here, but who knows? I have an open mind about it. You know, this, I'm not going to get pinned down definitionally to what's going to happen in the future either. We might go to another dwelling place, we might not. We might stay here, we might not. Or we say, yes, we're going to stay here, and yes, we're not going to stay here. Yes, we're going to leave, and yes, we're not going to leave. And of course, then the ego's fuming, mad. What kind of teacher are you? You an idiot. You know, you're telling anybody anything. And we're blocking the ego so then we can get clarity about the situation. So refuse to accept that anyone else's problems really are problematical. It's our own continuity fear that's the only problem we have. It's our own continuity fear that's the only problem we have. Now, do others have continuity fear? Of course they all do. Does that amplify mine? Of course. But I'm completely in control of setting down, evaporating my continuity fear. Therefore, they cannot stop me. Nobody can stop me. You say that nobody can stop me from feeling the feeling of eternal life. No one can stop me. As long as I evaporate my continuity fear, then I'm going to feel the feeling of eternal life. And no matter how severe others' continuity fears is, it cannot block me. It cannot. So then you don't struggle with people so much. You don't struggle with them. I don't feel any need to go out, you know, and socialize with people or anything. I don't need to. Because I know I'm the one with the problem. My problem is my problem. I have to evaporate that. If I don't evaporate that, I'm going to be miserable, no matter who I socialize with. So, and same with them. Same with them. That's why monasticism arose. That people realize that when you repent, you realize, I got the problem. It does, you know, if other people solve the problem, I still have the problem. I have to resolve. I have to evaporate my continuity fear. Absolutely, I do. Now, when I evaporate it, it'll help others too. But they still have to evaporate theirs. Like that, see? And we can't get together and collectively agree what we're going to project it and say, well, we don't have it, but it's over there, and think we escaped it. This is what the world's doing right now. A lot of the hive mind thing, and you know, it's groups getting together and say, well, we don't really have the problem. It's that group over there that has the problem. Okay. And conversely, you get groups projecting onto you, and they project all their problems onto you, and you think you have all the problems, which is, you know, part of the problem with America. Being a white male in America is the world has projected all its own continuity fear onto us, and saying, you know, once you get rid of your, you know, terrible wickedness, we'll all be happy. You're the one with the problem. So, but that doesn't work that way. They all have severe continuity problems, and they're refusing to take responsibility for their own problems, continuity problem, and just projecting it on, you know, on a convenient scapegoat, which has to be white American males right now. So we say, look, no, I'm going to solve my continuity problem, and as I do, I'm realizing, you know, it's the only problem I have. I do not have the problem of causing your continuity problem. I'm not causing your continuity problem. You are. Okay? This is called individual responsibility, which the ego is, you know, furiously trying to undermine. You know, the criminal saying, no, it's the police that have the problem. We're not criminals. It's the police that are criminalizing us. You know, it's gone this far. This is a sign of lunacy. It's a sign of egoic insanity gripping the world. Is literally, you're having this movement that's saying, is that, you know, we're not criminals at all. It's the police that are criminalizing us. You know, and then when the police say, okay, we'll withdraw, we'll stop criminalizing you, crime just goes crazy. Absolutely insane. It's called projection. It's projection. And so the ego teaches projection. It promotes rejection, projection. We have the projection in chief, you know, cheerleading all this, saying, yeah, this is great. You're finally getting it. You're finally doing what I want you to do. You know, you're going to be happy by doing this. Just project. You know, if you get together in a group, mob, and project on others that they're the ones who have the problem, you don't have any problem at all, then that's how you get free of your problem. This is the ego's religion. So we have the chief priest, you know, in the White House is the chief priest of the egoic cult of the world, actually. Encouraging projection. Okay. Both by saying and not responding to stuff. Both by responding and not responding to various things. The chief priest of the cult of egoic projection. And guess what? A lot of us know it. And those who don't like the fact that we know it, you know, we still know it. And we're not going to stop knowing, being aware of it. So the world is very sick. But also there are those in the world who are saying no to this. I said, this isn't right. Individual responsibility. You know, we have to take responsibility for our own continuity fear. Yes, it's a severe crippling fear. Yes, it's very okay. But it can be evaporated. Ramana Maharshi, for example, the very modern times, assured us that this is so. He said, absolutely, it will come out all right in the end. You just have to be very determined and persevere and work at it very, very intensely, and you'll succeed also, just as I have, you know. Now, he was already enlightened before he came into this world, actually. He had previously been a great Mahasiddha of a southern, some lineage in South India, apparently. So, you know, yeah, he just came in as a young person and decided, okay, it's time for me to start, you know, shining the feeling of eternal life into the world. And then that's what he did the rest of his life. But he assured us, you know, it doesn't work that way for you. So you have to work at it, because he'd already done it previously. Reincarnation is a fact that we have other times, other places where we, you know, have work on it. And if you finally succeed, you can return to the world just to shine the feeling of eternal life in the world. You can do that if that's what the Holy Spirit indicates. Sure, absolutely. So if, when we wake up and when we feel the feeling of eternal life, then we could return if that's what the Holy Spirit indicates, and we would just shine that feeling of eternal life in the world, and we wouldn't have any problem. Right now, though, as Ramana already said, you have a problem. You have a severe continuity problem, which requires great diligence and effort. Now, the non-dual teaching, there's been a lot of talk about that. And, you know, you can look at it glass half empty, glass half full. But what they really should be doing, and some have maybe, will say that, they say, yeah, you can get it right now. It's just right now. But you're not getting it right now. So, you know, gain the wisdom of why is it that you're not getting it right now? And so they just keep, you know, keep working at it. So, you know, it's like they say, non-dual teachers, well, you should be able to just get, look at it like this. Some say, oh, a guy came to me in 5 minutes. That was it. He was free. You know, like, well, really? It's that they keep repeating. You know, the idea is to keep repeating, and the wisdom, it's an attitude that they really should be imparting. You know, it's an attitude. Glass half full attitude. It's here right now. You know, what's wrong with right now? Various stuff. It's this attitude. And the tools, they should have the tools, you know, that we're talking about here. So it's a little confusing to people, they think, you know, but it's just, it's both, you know, they think we should be able to get it quick. You should have the attitude that it's, in theory, you know, it's already there. Okay, great. Now, you know, how do I remove the blocks to the awareness of the love's presence, the presence of eternal life? How do I, you know, not depart from it? So what we're saying here is that why are we depart from it? Because we want to be more helpful. The ego indicates a way to us that we can be more helpful. Okay. But you can't be any more helpful than shining eternal life. Ramana Maharshi said that the best thing you can possibly do for anyone, and nothing else is even close, is your own enlightenment, your own abidance in the self. Said that's the very best help you can give in the world. Nothing else comes close. So when the ego says you can do better than that, it's a lie. It's a flat-out lie. The reason why it doesn't seem, you know, is that we could help more is because we don't recognize the continuity fear in people. When you recognize a severe continuity fear is what's really going on, then you realize, yeah, shining eternal life is the motivational factor that they need. They need the motivational factor. Okay. Without that, they have no hope. They're going to get lost in the complexity. They're going to project all sorts of complexities. No matter what spiritual path they take, they're going to get all these complexities going on. Trying to get better, trying to figure out, well, there must be some higher state that can just remove everybody's difficulty and just enlighten them like that. No, it doesn't exist. Because their fear is that they stop pretending, they will no longer have any functionality, be devoid of functionality. And they're totally in control of their own experiencing and their own continuity fear. So you have no will that can overcome them. All have equal will. So nobody has a greater will than someone else. So it's impossible to force anybody. Totally impossible. And of course, the ego thinks, no, you, if you just get a stronger will, you can impose that will on everybody else. That is not true, because the situation here is a drastic fear of being devoid of functionality, and our spiritual will say, no, I'm not going to agree to that. And there's, nobody can be forced. Nobody can be forced. It's impossible. Very autumnal day here, August 30th. Beautiful autumnal day. Now, we go over and over and over this, why it's extremely important. September is a month that we're going to worry about, maybe worry about in October. Right? So what is September? September is a month that we might, maybe, yes, maybe no, worry about in October. Maybe October, maybe not October. But we'll just say, you know, I mean, we could just go on infinite regress here, but we don't need to do that. Well, so maybe in October. It's a maybe in October. October's a maybe for this. October's a maybe for this. How do I... All right. Going to... So we're just, I'm just going to keep, you know, keep on hammering away at this. Keep on hearing it. The more you hear it, the more it sinks in. The more it sinks in. The more you hear it, the more it sinks in. So just let it keep, you know, we'll keep working. Let this sink in. Maybe October we'll deal with September. Maybe October we'll deal with September. We're not going to judge September in September. All right? We're not going to judge it. We're going to keep working here on this. This is very fruitful what we're doing. And it's absolutely fruitful and absolutely not fruitful. This is absolutely fruitful and absolutely not fruitful. And of course, the ego will say, well, you sound very ambivalent. I got a teaching that's not ambivalent at all. Come over here and say, well, yeah, I both agree with you and don't agree with you, ego. I'm absolutely hear what you're saying and absolutely don't hear what you're saying. Well, what about my invitation? Well, I absolutely accept your invitation, absolutely do not accept your invitation. Well, that's very ambivalent. Yes, it's very ambivalent and very not ambivalent. So the ego hates this technique. You know, it absolutely hates it. Absolutely, it'll try everything possible to attack it somehow. It hates it. It can't get its teeth into you. It can't get a bite hold on you. You know, Jesus said, agree with your adversary quickly, lest he pull you before the judge and you be judged, meaning pulling you into judgment. Definition. Right? So the ego say, well, you've agreed to accept my invitation? Absolutely, I've agreed and I've absolutely not agreed. Well, which is it? Well, it's absolutely this and absolutely not this. It's absolutely both and absolutely neither. So yeah, it's absolutely both and absolutely neither. And the ego tries to pin you down and say, well, I absolutely accept your invitation and absolutely do not accept your invitation. The ego say, well, which is it? I say, well, it's absolutely both of those and absolutely neither of those. Absolutely both and absolutely neither. It's absolutely both and absolutely neither. And it's absolutely both and neither, and absolutely neither, both and neither. See, and you can just go infinite regress that way, right? Again, a big relaxation. So when we say we're going to allow September to be evaluated, maybe in October, we're giving ourselves this grace period. You see, this is how we do it. We give ourselves a grace period. And we can say to the ego, maybe I'll consider being a greater teacher in my next life, ego. Okay. Not this life, but maybe in the next life I'll be this ultimate teacher that you know, hold out to me. So do it that way. Oh, really? I mean, I can be an even greater teacher? Okay. Well, you know, I'm not going to do it this life. I'm busy with it right now, but, you know, maybe next life I can do that, ego. Well, we'll see. Yeah, maybe next life, maybe not. Which is it? Well, it's both and neither. What do you mean both? Well, it's both and neither, and neither, both and neither. And it's both and neither, and neither, and not neither. There you go. It gets a little tricky. Go back one more, doesn't it? It's possible to go back even more. One more. It's both, not neither, and not both and neither, and it's neither, both, not neither, and not both and neither. There you go. That's even one more step back. So, sure, ego, maybe I'll consider what you have to say next life. Talking about stuff, various stuff, whatever you want to say. Maybe I'll entertain you next life. Maybe. And maybe I'll have a next life, maybe I won't. Maybe I'll entertain you, maybe I won't. But, you know, maybe. I'm not saying no, it's possible, right? Yeah, sure it's possible. So maybe I will, maybe I won't. So, the ego knows that the motivation of feeling the feeling of eternal life, that motivation is essential for us. And so it tries to block that at all costs. So anybody that can radiate the feeling of eternal life here is ready. It tries to say, hey, you can be better than that. You know, you know, reach a higher goal. You know, it tries to prevent you from doing this. By offering you, telling you, well, there's something much better than that, you're going to be more helpful. But it's all important to have this motivation. If you, without that motivation, the help just goes in one ear and out the other. Without a repentant mind, the help goes in one ear and out the other. So whatever the ego wants to say or whatever, we'll entertain that in October, maybe. So, the ego knows that September is its power month, and it thinks it's going to strike us, you know, like that, but it's not. So I'm going to give everybody a 1 month vacation from commenting, as it were, on the videos, because you need to push everything into October, because we're taking this jubilee right now, actually, where we're going to take this position of, well, it both is and it isn't. Okay, we're going to practice this. So we don't want to be definitional during this month of September in terms of words, of writing, of those kind of definitional things. Okay, very great. This is enough for now, and we're going to move forward with this. Absolutely great. We're both going to move forward and not move forward. We're going to deal with September, maybe in October.